organizers for inviting to this conference. I enjoyed so far. I hope, until the end I will still be enjoying. So I'm given a final presentation for which I'm also grateful to organizers. So I have a opportunity to criticize everybody and not being criticized back in further presentations. So so I also want to continue tradition of putting trees in the turbulence presentation, right? So to illustrate what kind of system I'm considering, right? In my case, it's also the vortices, as we know, the trees, right? So, but in my case, how does it work? Okay. Yeah, but in my case, it is a dark forest. It's a dark forest in which we often find ourselves in the middle of the, as you know, including this guy. So you see, system is quite actually similar in type as Nir Navon was presenting in his experiment. And somebody in the end asked, what about vortices? Have you seen vortices? Well, there's plenty of vortices, if you by vortices you mean zero, so the field. But you don't see them precisely because they're dark. They're dark and obscure. In other words, they are ghost vortices. It's a weakly nonlinear field, a lot of zeros. This is the isopycnal lines that set at the density 0.03 of the mean density. So this means it indicates where the vortices are. And you see how they are unstructured and numerous, right, in this case. Okay, so, and because of that, we have to follow this guy through the circles of hell to uncover the truth. So, but we'll start on the bright side, right? So we'll start with cheer ourselves by writing the Gross-Peterski equation again, okay, and conserved quantities that it has, the particles and the total energy. I forgot to remove S here. S is minus one because the from place I was cutting and pasting it from, I also considered focus and case as well. But it's minus one for in this work. And the wave turbulence, I gave three lectures in last week. I won't repeat everything, but those of you who were present saw me deriving this kinetic equation. And again, so I was cutting and pasting from a place where this was considered in general. So for Gross-Peterski, this is just one. Okay, this is interaction coefficient is equal to one. And omega is a frequency which is equal to k squared. And so this kinetic equation, so the conserved quantities, the particles and energy in terms of this kinetic equation in terms of the spectrum, wave function or particle spectrum, becomes simply integral of the spectrum and integral of k squared times the spectrum. And again, I said last week, and I repeat here again, so these are exact integrals of this equation, but if you compare them with what we had in the previous page, n is precisely the same, but h is given by only the first part, because the system is weakly nonlinear, and therefore this fourth degree term is much smaller than the second degree term. But in the kinetic equation, it becomes exact. In the Gross-Peterski system equation, it is an approximate integral. So, in other words, wave turbulence is an approximation. Okay, so, and as I just said to you, even though this is wave turbulence, right, the dynamical objects here that are essential, they are waves in the spectrum of waves. But there is a lot of vortices, but they all ghosts. It's all, you know, it's all this kind of system. It's not even point talking a lot about them because they don't play any dynamical role. We can't close equations in terms of the vortices, position of vortices themselves, right? So the dynamically important quantities in this case are waves. So the again, I mean, a lot we heard here already, and including in my lecture course about the dual cascade behavior. So that is analogous to 2D turbulence, where we have the standard Fjortov argument for direct cascade of entropy and inverse cascade of energy. And in wave turbulence, it is this identical argument leads to the conclusion that energy cascades to forward to high wave numbers, and wave action cascades backward. And in terms of Gross-Pytaevsky, wave action is particles. Okay? So, wave action is particles. Just to avoid possible confusion, whatever, in some talks we heard about inverse cascade, it was system of hydrodynamic type. It was system of this type, and therefore energy was exactly like here. So we're not talking about entropy energy, we're talking about energy and wave action. It's a weakly nonlinear system. So which, in the context of both Einstein condensates, has a nice interpretation. So this is a sketch from our paper with Yuri Lvov and Rob West, which in 2003, where we just illustrate what does it mean in terms of if now we put a system in a trap, and we and the trap is such that it has finite height, something that was implemented last year in experiment of Nir Napon, that's called synthetic dissipation, implementing the finite height of the trap, right? And so in that, this is, of course, was the purely mind Gedanken experiment, right? So with this kind of, but the final height of the trap was precisely suggested here so that to allow dissipation of energy, to lose energy out of the system. So then immediately you can see if you put your initial excitations somewhere at the intermediate position in the trap, right? So then and look, what is going to be energy cascade will be to higher levels, and the particle cascade will be to lower levels. And you immediately see that it's could be now be interpreted cascade of particles is a non-equilibrium Bose condensation, right? We are moving toward ground states, right? And the motion of energy and eventual spilling over the barrier dissipation, this is like evaporative cooling. So, of course, again, not to confuse with real evaporative cooling that we used to obtain Bose condensate, because that was applied to a system which is not yet in a state that could be described by Gross-Pytaevsky, right? And only after losing a lot of particles, it becomes like that. But you could think of the experiment, possible experiment, where you produce a condensate, and then you somehow maybe shape your trap at rather high frequency so that you kick your system at the high levels, and then stop shaking and watch this system to settle back in the equilibrium position. And this kind of solutions I will be talking about. Another thing, okay, so perhaps it's not not directly relevant to my work, but a kind of interesting thing that was we found in the, that whole paper, is that when condensate is formed, right, so you go into another regime where the acoustic, where perturbation behaves as a Bogoliubov sound. And what is interesting, that the perturbations tend to concentrate in between of edge of the trap and the condensate slope. So more here and less in the middle. There's no reflection points. You freely pass through that region. But you pass by accelerating here and slowing down here, so that your density is like a ring in there. And I think that was Elaine was showing some experiments where this kind of behavior, or maybe similar behavior, observed. All right. So now the Kolmogorov-Zakharov spectra, right? So these are the scaling, the Pavlov spectra is supposed to be solutions of wave kinetic equation, right? Corresponding to the constant energy and particle flux, or energy particle cascades, that processes that were from which happen in the opposite directions to each other. So from from the theory, I discussed last week. So the predictions for the exponents are like this. For the energy cascade is minus d, d being dimension, and for the particle cascade minus d plus 2/3. So another thing I mentioned last week, that this spectra only makes sense, only meaningful if they are local. If I plug back into them in the wave kinetic equation and it converges. Otherwise, they are simply not solution, not a valid mathematical solution for the wave kinetic equation. If the integral converges, then they are exact solutions of the wave kinetic equation. Okay. It turns out that in 3D, the cascade spectrum is local, so totally valid, nice solution. The forward energy cascade is divergent, but it's log divergent, right? And we're physicists, we accept that log divergent solutions actually are not so bad, and we can even fix them, right, by log corrections. So, which in this particular case gives us this log correction, so where F is a forcing scale. So the spectrum is actually steeper than would be without log correction because it diverges at the forcing scale, right? So it is steeper. So it could be that this might be an explanation why in experiments of Navon et al. The spectrum was reported a bit steeper, 3.5 instead of 3 exponent. It's possible. So in 2D, situation is even much worse because it's a very degenerate case. The because one of the spectra, the for the energy cascade exponent coincides with thermodynamic partition, and for the inverse cascade, there's something bad, other bad thing happening that will the prediction for direction of the flux is in the opposite direction, contradicting Fyodorov theorem. I'm not going to discuss that. What does it mean? I'm just going to mention that in this case, it's known that KZ spectra won't be realized. And what will be realized, so-called warm cascade states, which look almost like thermodynamic equilibrium distribution, but with slight corrections to accommodate for the fluxes that go through Fourier space on background of thermodynamic solutions. So that's another thing from my paper with Miguel Anarata showing exactly 2D. So forcing direct cascade and forcing inverse cascade, and in both cases exponents minus 2 on the initial stages. So then if you don't force, so if you just let the turbulence evolve, right? So some interest in scaling, intermediate scaling regimes occur, right? So I won't discuss this case because we don't even have theory about that yet. Okay, I'll discuss similar things about 3D in a minute. But just to sort of for completeness, I will say that, okay, we'll have a lot of ghost vortices, unstructured random waves. And then they, these vortices start annihilating. And then annihilate until the mean distance between vortices becomes bigger than the Hilbert length. And then they become real vortices they, that move like real hydrodynamic vortices. But then, okay, so I guess this intermediate regime could last for a while, and maybe negative temperature states can be achieved in that intermediate regime. But eventually, if you move toward equilibrium, we expect them all annihilate. So we saw them this happening here in the periodic box simulation. And but the energy is still there. Energy is in the acoustic perturbations. And these acoustic perturbations, it's another type of weakly nonlinear system. Now the weakness, the about new equilibrium. So initial state, it's around zero. And new, it's about the coherent condensate. So it is a uniform component that rotating, okay, and then around it, usual classical Bogoliubov sound, and the weak nonlinear theory for such sound, it's a three-wave Bogoliubov, three-wave process, wave turbulence process. So in other words, we have two weakly nonlinear regimes. One is four-wave initially without condensate, De Broglie waves. Then another one where symmetry is broken. We have Bogoliubov sound on background of condensate. And sandwiched between them is a strongly nonlinear regime characterized by hydrodynamical point vortices moving. The before this one. So the spectral wave action spectrum, that is. That's a 1D wave action spectrum, meaning average over angle. So the exponent is, for 1D spectrum, exponent is minus one. If you average, you add the Jacobian two pi r, so. Yes, the psi k mod squared, yes, that will be n, yeah, in this case, wave action. Okay, let me set, actually forgot to set time. Okay, so what time did I start? Okay, then you tell me till the end, right? Okay, so please remind me each 10 minutes. Okay. Yeah. In this case, it's forced. The next slide, it's freely decaying. So we start with some putting some random waves into high wave numbers, and we'll let system evolve. Okay, so the as usual, these blue dots, this is a color plot of density in physical space. So these blue dots, these are the vortices. We can't say positive or negative, they both have density close to zero, right? Now 3D, so that's a work with Davide and Miguel. What's interesting, okay, so we see this wave turbulence prediction actually, well, it's actually the inertial range is very small scaling range, but at least it's consistent, right? What's some yes, and of course, in this range, it's not possible to talk about log correction, and probably the spectrum, the other spectrum, 3.5. Well, in this case, it would be one minus 1.5. You could probably also fit with, you know. So, it's consistent. But what's interesting, to achieve this state, you actually have to force at the lowest wave numbers. You have to dissipate friction, introduce friction. If you don't do that, you see totally different behavior. You will start condensing, piling up energy at lowest wave numbers, and it will break your locality of turbulence eventually. So you can choose another dissipation, so-called hypoviscosity, right? It's k to some negative power, right? So in analogy with hyperviscosity, k to positive power to dissipate high wave numbers. So dissipate low wave numbers, you can do, you know, negative power of k. And you see if these powers, here's the simulation, and you see with that kind of dissipation, we don't get to KZ spectrum, but we have to some other scaling regime, which looks like different by one, the index, the Paolo exponent. And that, we argued, is a critical balance state. So what is critical balance? It's a concept that was suggested to describe MHD turbulence, saying that the nonlinear and the equilibrium state settles in a condition where linear and nonlinear processes happen at the same time scale at each scale, right? So we just get the dynamical equation. Linear time scale will be linear wave period, nonlinear time scale given by nonlinearity. And let's say in Fourier space, we equate one to another of order of magnitude Tweedle, and we get this new scaling. So this is what critical balance was suggested. If we apply it to Gross-Pitayevsky, we get another scaling solution. And as far as I understand, I mean, what van der Ley was, had a paper with collaborators about grains in ABC turbulence. And my understanding was that these grains are precisely of the of such scale, of the of order of non, the Hillian length, and they kind of they're packed close to each other. And if you think about that, that is similar. So the linear and nonlinear time scale in Gross-Pitayevsky equate each other precisely at the Hillian length, right? So if you have something that packed side by side Hillian length grains. So that is probably a state similar to the critical balance. So linear and nonlinear processes are in balance. You talk about this or this? It is a forced turbulence. So we're forcing here, we're dissipating here, right? And here, well, we see some scale, looks like Paolo, yes. And these are the different forcing amplitudes. Okay, but that's not what my talk is about. My talk is about my recent collaboration, some of it is still ongoing, with a colleague and friend, Vishwanath Shukla, evolving 3D Gross-Pitayevsky turbulence. And first of all, and we want to compare, well, Vishwanath is doing direct numerical simulations of this equation in corresponding settings. But there were some previous predictions based on the wave kinetic equation. So let's first of all introduce back the wave kinetic equation. But now I change the variable, instead of k, I introduce frequency, and also I assume that the spectrum is isotropic, so it depends on only on modulus k or only on frequency, and integrate out the angles, the solid angles in wave number space, which will give me the following kernel, okay, when I integrate out the solid angles. Okay. So Then the theory. The theory and some simulation of the kinetic equation. And the theory was first in paper Semikos and Kachov, and then Sergio Rica, Lacaze et al. Okay, Sergio was in there, so got similar results. Okay, so which are, well, yes, exactly. So I'm going to, so this is a picture from Semikos and Kachov that shows evolution. Okay, so they started, they computed the kinetic equation, and they found that, so starting at small scales, right, it's high wave numbers, and they found that it very quickly gets attracted to self-similar regime, such that the spectrum has two parts, one constant part, which is shrinking and growing, and another part with some power law. And this power law, even though it's not clearly seen here, if you can see here, there's a line here, okay? The line is KZ prediction, the Kolmogorov-Zakharov spectrum. So, and this is an anomalous power law. So this line is exponent minus 1.16, and the observed numerically exponent is minus 1.23. Tiny, but when you have so many orders of magnitude of scaling range, you can clearly see that they are distinct. And here is this exponent is just measured spatially, and you can see. So here's KZ exponent, and you can see clearly you kind of saturate here at a value 1.23. And so this is self-similarity of the second kind. Okay, it's a more tricky self-similarity than the first type self-similarity, where all the self-similar coefficients, including the such power laws, can be obtained from conservation of energy or some other invariant. So here, you can't do that because the self-similar part of solution contains only a tiny amount of energy. You can't use total conservation of energy because most of energy is not in the self-similar part, right? And you have to solve this non-linear eigenvalue problem. So this is kind of Zildovich's terminology, second type self-similarity. And I just remind, in Sergio's talk, he considered the vortex reconnection. That was also this type of solution, second order self-similarity. Now, it is characterized by a front that propagating and blows out at T star. So no matter, you know, where I start, I will reach k equal to zero. I mean, most of the particles will collapse onto k equal to zero in finite time, into some T star time. So, and this is different, makes a difference from first type self-similarity where front propagates in infinite time. So you get closer and closer to zero, but you never reach it. Okay. So it's funny that this constant behavior we can actually obtain analytically if we assume that the interaction in kinetic equation, if I write it for say scales here, is dominated by the largest wave numbers. So this is called non-locality property, right? If you do that, you get some simple differential equation, the solution of which is k to power zero. That's it. And then, a posteriori, you check that indeed k equal to zero gives you divergent integral at ultraviolet cutoff, right? But because we don't have infinite range, we don't have divergence, we have just dominance of interaction by the UV cutoff. So this is nice, but as I said, okay, unfortunately, this exponent you can't get so easy. And so even though this papers, it was found by evolution problem, now we are trying to recover it, okay, to re-examine it by using the self-similar substitution, which gives us equation which gives us equation in, integral differential equation in self-similar variable, which I did not write here. So instead of two variables, time and omega, we have only one self-similar variable. And that it makes it tricky to solve, because now you have to do iterations, iterative schemes that are terrible. They don't want to converge. And there is no theory, because they are nonlinear, right? So you have to do a lot of tricks and you know, try to tame it, you know. So that's what we are trying to do right now. So TAR is determined by initial condition. So the solution is actually scale invariant, right? So you can rescale it, okay, you can get different T star. It determined by how much particles initially you have and energy. So T star is not universal, in other words. But what is universal is this, this scaling behavior, the exponents. Correct, yeah. Grosperski doesn't blow up. So, and this is a good point. How many? Okay, great. So, and this is a great point. Well, first of all, blow up in this case means not blowing up at high wave numbers, not creating the smaller scale, but blowing up, creating the macroscopically occupied k equal to zero mode, breaking symmetry, creating the coherent. And while you do that, inevitably, if you allow a small enough k, close enough to T star, you will break assumptions under which wave kinetic equation is valid. This is trivial to understand, because wave kinetic equation, for it to work, the nonlinear evolution time has to be slower than the wave period. But if solution is such that it's accelerating and the speed of the solution becomes tends to infinity close to T star, obviously the nonlinear time scale gets smaller and smaller, gets to zero, and you break. At this point, you actually look in a physical space and you see vortices and you see transition to hydrodynamic regime. Okay. So now I will show you some results from direct numerical simulation of Gross-Peterski equation. So forced at where this initial peak, blue peak is shown. And you see, so initially it develops this power law. And in fact, okay, because it's 1D k, it meaning, I multiplied by 2 pi k, I angled averaged it, right? So it carries this slope proportional to k, k to first power, it's actually the same as constant here. So we recovered this constant behavior, the constant. So later, so which one is next? Yes, later, because it's sorry, k squared, yes, exactly, it's k squared. And this is k squared, yes. Slope is 2, yes, it's written here, okay. Yes, yes, so, yes, thank you. So, I got it wrong. 4 pi k squared. The sphere of radius of sphere of radius k. So, and then you see this range is shrinking, and we have exponent, another exponent emerging. Right, and this exponent turns out to be one, which is different from 0.46 that was obtained for the kinetic equation. But don't get disappointed, because I'll show you in a minute 512 simulation, and things seem to get better there. Now, after this regime, what I want to show is you switch yet to another, you reach, okay, T star, and after T star, you reach this kind of regime. So this constant is actually energy equipartition, it's a thermal spectrum, right? And you would say, okay, so what is usual picture in condensates? You say some delta function at k equal to zero, And then the thermal spectrum for larger K, right? Thermal fluctuations. So I got thermal fluctuations, but I don't get delta function K equal to zero. Instead, I get another scaling, rather steep, but it's a scaling. So the message is the condensate is not perfect, right? It has some coherence, coherent structure, but it's not just uniform K equal to zero. It's forced and it's dissipated at high wave numbers, but not at low wave numbers. It's forced at high wave numbers and it dissipated at even higher wave numbers. So yes, and this is just the same two last graphs, but in terms of energy, just to convince you that this is the thermal spectrum, usual K squared. Okay. So is system weakly nonlinear or not? Assumed by wave kinetic equation. At initial stages, yes. So I don't know why Vishwanath put negative omegas, but it's actually probably it was spectrum of psi star, not psi. But yes, it is K squared, right? So it's a very nicely weakly nonlinear system. At initial stages, at initial, hey? This is dissipation. Here, the gap, okay, yes, this is nonlinear frequency shift. Even without any condensate, right? So there is, this K squared is there actually, not seen. It's slightly above, right? Yes? Well, actually, no, okay. It is, zero is right here. Yes, it's just slightly bigger regions, okay. So. Yes, okay, I'm sorry, okay. So this is a spectral transform done simultaneously in space and in time. And this is the way such a representation is the easy way to see whether you follow, what kind of structures contain there. You have the weakly nonlinear waves, something else. What can be something else? Like here, you see, there's something else emerging here. So this is a condensate, right? It's still weak, sufficiently weak, right? So these two branches, as usual, it's a psi star, a psi and psi star, right? Because the normal variables, they contain a combination of these two. Okay, so this is a zoom on this region, and you see the condensate is tilted. But okay, hold on, Giorgio. We're seeing this in the next slide. Okay. So it's tilted, right? It's tilted. Why it's tilted? Because, okay, so if you remember, if you have a moving object, right? So it will be like a tilted line, and the speed of this object will be the slope of this line, right? Now, what's interesting, I can actually, with this representation, I can cut out the spectrum here, and I can integrate over wave numbers and plot the spectrum just of this component. That's another nice thing. You separate components and plot their spectra separately. So I plot spectrum of a condensate and I get this nice power law given just with condensate without waves, right? So, and then moving object, okay, so these are probably the thing that give us tilt. So because it's like vortex rain, it will have some velocity of motion, right? Don't know yet exactly, but this would be natural to assume. And one more thing, you know, you see now our sad and obscure dark vortices all of a sudden become more cheerful, right? So that is vorticity is now vortices are here, they kind of well separated, they become like more real hydrodynamic vortices. They can do all sorts of Kalin waves and reconnections and all sorts of nice things that we heard about in this conference. The here what I show particles and okay and particles and condensate, which is zero. Okay, so this is initial particles. You shed them, and then they become pretty much constant. So it's from initial condition shed, and when particles start propagating to lower wave numbers, they start getting conserved. And then, but the condensate fraction, you see it at 10 to minus 4. It's very small. So it's, in terms of kinetic equation, you have it growing. It's growing, right, at k equal to 0. But in terms of the Gross-Petersky real dynamical equations, it's actually it's growing at first several modes. It's not exactly at k equal to 0, right? So, and if I consider only k equal to 0, it's only a tiny amount there, and it jumps in and out. Maybe it jumps to k equal to 1, then back, and so that's this kind of things. So finally, that's a good news. 512, comparing now with predictions of based on wave kinetic equation of Sergio. Okay, so k squared is still there, good, and we have another exponent which is pretty convincing, -0.75, which is still bigger than the previous result, 4.6. But if we changed from -1 to -0.75 by changing the resolution from 256 to 512, it's natural to assume that if you change resolution to 1024, maybe you get something even more close. Maybe, okay, so, but it is a very expensive computation, so, I mean, because computing weakly nonlinear system is much harder than computing a strongly nonlinear system. It is just does not want to evolve. It is very a lot of recurrences. It's very slow. It's incredibly slow. And yet you need to resolve each oscillation of linear wave, which is a lot of them, right? So it's almost a losing game, and unless you have a very big access to big machines. Okay. And summary. Okay, so non-equilibrium condensation is characterized by self-similar evolution with an anomalous power law scaling. And the, it's of the second type. So the condensation reaching k equal to 0 happens at a finite time. Post-T-star evolution characterized by condensate plus thermal excitations, which is not k equal to 0 mode only, but which is some rather steep power law. We have some structures there. Maybe if we wait, if you have very big box, you know, tending to infinity, maybe we can get closer to just delta function at k equal to 0. But at this point, we say it's a steep power law. Finally, there is a question. So where's the inverse cascade KZ spectrum? It's a nice spectrum. It's a, it, theoretically, it, it's a local and everything. But how can we implement it? We need some sort of dissipation at low wave numbers. Is that at all possible to do experimentally, dissipate ground state? So this is this would be nice. But at the moment, I don't have a solution for that. Okay, thank you very much. I don't know actually. So, well, okay, because you're kind of preaching. Yes. But the process, remember, it's self-accelerating. At the time scales we are looking at, so for reaching a very fast. So you. Okay. Into high wave numbers, right? Remember, the at high wave numbers you have dissipation. So you're reaching kind of balance where what you created the forcing is dissipated at high wave numbers, but the part that kind of separates from the forcing, it's almost independent because it's self-accelerating that moves towards zero. It doesn't really care what happens at high wave numbers, which is at slower time scale. Okay, this you can ignore something is evolving at slow time scale and not conserved at high wave numbers. Oh yes, she has been doing it for ages.